I'm very fortunate today to be joined by Mr. Than Lochotinan, the country head of Capco Thailand. So I would love to explain to you what Capco does. I can say that they're very involved digital transformation projects, but I think it'd be better to hear it right from the source. Than, why don't you tell us a little bit about who you are and what Capco Thailand does?
Sure. I'm the head of Thailand for Capco, the management consulting and IT consulting company that operates globally. So we focus on financial services, and in particular in Thailand, we focus on banking and insurance industry. As for myself, I've spent pretty much most of my career in management consulting, in financial services. I've been working for global IT consulting company, as well as three of the big fours in the past. So I'm very happy to be here and talking to you today, David.
Cool. Well, thanks, Than. So listen, I think one of the most valuable insights that management consultants like you would have to share is your experience working with executives across the industry and across the country, and I imagine in many respects you speak to global leaders as well. So as it relates to your business today, so we're talking about digital transformation and changes in consumer behavior as it relates to financial services. What are you hearing? What are executives and leaders talking to you about? What are their problems? What are they working on?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on who you speak to. If you get a chance to speak to the CEO of the company, then I guess his top agenda would be on the growth strategy, how to grow the business, how to sell more, and how also to save on the operational side of things as well. If you talk to the CTO of the company or the CIO of the company, then his agenda would be mostly on the digital and innovation. So everyone is doing digital transformation these days, but what kind of things that they should focus their efforts on that would be in line with the growth strategy. You'll be surprised how many CTOs I get to speak to whose vision and ambition are not aligned with the CEO, and then that kind of creates a certain tension in terms of the strategy and the roadmap for the company. And then if you get to speak to the chief people officer, then what he or she would have in mind would be on the people side of things, the organization, how the organization can align themselves to the changes that are going in terms of the digital to be aligned with the growth strategy. And within the growth strategy, there's a book that I read about 2-3 years ago called What's Your Digital Business Model, which is a very good book. I can recommend that resonates to today as well. It kind of specifies that there are four kinds of business models in a company. You can either be a supplier, you can either be a omni-channel, could be a what they call the modular producer or ecosystem driver, and that depends on how much you want to understand about customer experience on one axis, and the other axis is your business model. Is it a value chain based or is it a ecosystem based? So let me give you an example. So example of a company that is value chain with limited knowledge of customer experience traditionally would be industries like insurance. Right? So insurance that would be coming up with a product that they think the consumers want to buy, but their distribution channel would be through brokers, through agents. So they don't really own the customer intimacy, right? Yeah. Because that belongs to the bank assurance, the banks that sell their products, or the agents or the brokers. So they pretty much sit on the supplier side, but you see a trend that they're trying to move themselves to omni-channel, where you're still a value chain kind of business, but you know your customer, you own the customer relationship. And this is where you'll see most banks sit. They have loads of products, they own the customer interactions, they want to develop innovative ideas to talk and to get close to the customer, to know what the customer wants. So some of the insurers are kind of moving up to that, to do the direct selling. They want to know what the customer wants and sell directly. So that's another model that most of the banks are.
So in that model, do you think that they're hoping someday, or they're planning someday to distribute to those customers directly? Is that where you think they're heading?
They could be heading that direction, or some of them are kind of leaping towards the ecosystem driver, and this is where the money is, really. You see some of the banks in Thailand have already been launching products that are non-banking, right? They just want to own the entire ecosystem of lifestyle, for example. Mm-hmm. For example, Siam Commercial Bank has launched Robin Hood, which is food delivery business. So those that sits on the ecosystem driver would be those who have business based on ecosystem, have customer intimacy. You'll see companies such as Grab, for example, or those super apps that they just want to address all of the customers' need. So they have food delivery, they have travel, they even have Grab Finance, so cutting the piece of pie from the banks these days. And businesses that model themselves as a platform, so for example, Uber, they don't own any cars, but or Grab, that meant they don't own any cars, but they're the platform for the transportation, or Airbnb, they don't own any rooms, but or even Facebook, they don't own any content, but they are the platform for people to put in the content and capturing all those systems. So for a bank, if a bank, for example, they could explore the home loan ecosystem whereby traditionally they just offer banking products, like a home loan product, and that's it, right? So in the future, those banks who have ambition to be the ecosystem player can also offer services like interior design, architects, even moving services to capture the entire thing of if I want to buy a home or own a home, what do I need, right? So that's the entire ecosystem. For insurance, for life and health insurance, they would be trying to capture the health ecosystem. So all the telemedicine, you can be tracking the wearables beyond just a standard traditional health insurance package premium, that kind of thing.
Well, these things are all connected, aren't they? I mean, if you look at, let's say from a product perspective, if we're talking about, let's say, a medical insurance policy or even a life insurance policy, there are ways to make it less expensive to the customer. And one of those ways is for that customer, to help that customer be healthier, maybe more active, eat better, these kinds of things. And so the way to do that involves a considerably closer relationship with that customer. Now, do you see that customer being willing to engage with an insurance company or a bank for those kinds of services?
Yes, if there are something in it for them. Mm. And what's in it for them is lower premium or certain rewards that you get from sharing your data, right? Because with life insurance, with health insurance, the incentive between the customer and the insurer is aligned, right? From the customer side, they don't want to be sick. And from the insurer side, they don't want their customers to claim so much. So it's with that interest to keep the customers as healthy as possible. And that, I want to be healthy too. So I would benefit from the content or whatever rewards that I get or incentive for keeping a healthy lifestyle, keeping fit, keeping healthy. So that benefit kind of both ways. So if I share those kind of data, if I wear like a wearable that can prove that I'm living an active life, and I know that if I can share that and I'm likely to get a lower premium next year, then that's an incentive for me to share that, to benefit from what I can get from the insurers.
In the economic incentive is a very good justification for giving some of your personal, quite personal data that an insurance company probably would not have had before. So that's, I think, part of the incentive can be economic, but I have to talk about the flip side of this. I mean, there's always going to be a privacy concern. There's always tales of insurance companies and boogeymen. And I think what I'm getting at is, if you're looking at this from the perspective of the technology and from the data that's required, how do you assuage the customer's fears and anxieties about parting with such personal data? How does an insurance company or any financial institution for that matter earn the trust of the customer as it relates to this new data that they're going to have about them?
Yeah, so they have to respect the data privacy. And now with the PDPA in most countries, and going to be in Thailand as well, the most important thing is to give the customer the choice of whether to permit certain kinds of data to be shared with the company, right? So yes, you can opt to share or not, depending on what the customers think and they can benefit from sharing the data, as I told you before. So it's up to them. So the customer will be in control of their data rather than trusting the third party or the insurer to be in control of the personal data. Yeah, so to provide that kind of confidence that the company is have integrity and respectful of the personal. It's not going to be shared, but you can also opt not to share the data with the company.
So in the instances where someone does share, I mean, here I can share my experience. I'm originally from Canada, and I can say that Canadians are I think much more concerned about privacy matters than what I've experienced in my travels in the Middle East, living in India, and here. It feels as though maybe the Thai are a little bit less concerned about privacy than would be North Americans, perhaps. But what do you think on that?
Well, I don't have the data between Thailand and Canada, but judging from online presence and social media footprint, like things like Instagram is very very popular in Thailand. And you'd be surprised how many people just post their photos without putting any privacy on it, and just that's available in the public. And some of these photos are less glamorous.
Okay. Well, maybe I'll ask it a different way then. If you're an ethical executive or an ethical company, and you're trying to say, hey, listen, Mr. Customer, I have a great value exchange for you. Give me some of your behavioral data, and I'll give you a great deal on your product. I'll help you be healthier, and I'll make it less expensive for you to have the coverage that you want anyway. How transparent do I need to be as that executive at that company with the Thai consumer?
Well, transparent. You have to be very transparent about what you're going to do with my data. I think the top concern is you're going to sell my data to third party and then get phone calls to sell me this and that. And that's part of the annoyance on everyday life. You get phone calls selling me insurance or like personal loans or something.
Okay, so in your experience then, the Thai are concerned about privacy to some measure, and there does need to be some type of disclosure explaining what will happen and what will not happen with data. And there is a choice that needs to be offered. Not every customer needs to give away that data.
Right.
Okay, so that's actually really fascinating. That's not a very different story than I've heard told in India or in Dubai or in Canada. But let's flip it back a little bit to a misalignment in visions between CTOs and CEOs. So can you describe what some typical examples would be of CTO vision and CEO vision not lining up?
So CTOs, they would be thinking about innovations within the company. What can they make? And these innovations are both in terms of digital transformation and experience transformation, right? So they're pretty much a spender. Right? CEOs have the balance between spender and his first friend, the CFO, who is just thinking about the ROI all the time. Right? And it's part of the challenge of getting some of the innovation projects through, because basically sexy innovation things cost money. That may not give a quantifiable return on investment. Right? So the important thing is being able to align the vision from the growth strategy. So what I mentioned before, like where do you see your company? Do you see your company as an omnichannel type of digital model, or do you try to be an ecosystem driver, or do you just want to participate in the ecosystem? That's very different things, and that kind of dictates what you want to do with digital transformation and experience transformation. So for example, if you're very customer-facing, like a bank, then you need to invest on the customer experience or the experience transformation bit. But if you want to be part of the ecosystem, but not so much, you don't require yourself to be knowing much about the customer. Companies like PayPal, for example, or C2P, those payment gateways, they're everywhere, right? But they don't really own the customer experience because they don't need to. They just latch on to Lazada or any other e-commerce platform.
They're a utility.
Yeah. So that kind of determines it. If you're that kind of company, then you don't have to invest so much on the customer experience. Maybe the user experience needs to be good, so the way that you make your payments has to be smooth and easy and everything.
Right.
Yeah, but not so much. It depends on where you see yourself. So that growth is what I'm telling you, that growth strategy is the starting point. Once the vision is aligned within the company, then the CTO or the chief people officer and CFO will need to align their agendas within that growth strategy.
Okay, so once that's done, CEO has presented the master plan for the next 3 to 5 years. We're going to be an ecosystem player.
Yeah.
That's what we're doing. The CTO, see, I've been involved in a few of these transformations where businesses have begun that journey towards becoming a platform.
Yeah.
And that's a heavy, heavy cultural shift for a number of businesses. Mm-hmm. Is this where some of the challenge lies for your typical CTO?
Yeah, it's not just the cultural, it's architectural shift in terms of IT as well. You can come up with your roadmap for experience transformation, but you're still using a legacy system, or your legacy system is stopping you from implementing the sexy, innovative stuff that you want to implement. So I think a lot of the work that we get from advising companies is how do we adapt the legacy systems to be working and to be enabling the digital transformation. In some cases, it's a matter of changing the core system to be a new digital core. But if you're a bank, changing your core is a big, big program, and you don't want to do that. Perhaps you want to make use of a middleware that would kind of act as a middle layer for you to enable all those innovation to be syncing and to be working in real time with your core system. And we have a lot of insurers at the moment who've been working on like an AS400. Based legacy system who are changing or considering of changing core systems, and now there are a lot of alternatives in the market for both banking and insurance alike to go on the software as a service kind of route, whereby you can quickly launch a digital core within a period of 3 to 6 months rather than years.
No, I've been involved in a few of the debates between spending the really big bucks that are necessary to go and grab an IBM core.
Yeah.
And I don't want to say it quite so crassly, but there are ways to make the big investment in one go, or ways to do it a little tiny bit along the way. What's happening here? Or is it not as straightforward to say that? Like in Thailand, are the insurance companies and the banks writing the big check? Are they easing into the transition, or is it a mixed bag here?
Mixed bag. There are various thinking, and the traditional thinking would be to have a fixed roadmap. So they would either come up with a roadmap internally or hire consultants like us to come up for a digital roadmap for them, right? And they'll say, okay, once you sign off, we'll stick to this roadmap and execute it in the next 3 to 5 years. Now, it's not practical in real life because technology changes, customer behavior changes, customer expectation changes, right? So you need to dynamically adapt. You can have those roadmap as a baseline, but you need to tune in and really apply kind of design thinking into everything that you do. And with the three principles, the key principles of design thinking is the customer focus, and then adapt your whatever products and continuously measure the experience that brings, right? So it's a balance that you have to do. And then the way that you kind of budget the project, that needs to change, to shift as well. So traditionally, you will assign a certain amount of the budget to this particular project and make sure that the project manager kind of sticks to this timeline and the budget. But that's not practical anymore. You have to be much more dynamic. So the shift here is to have the what we call the capacity kind of budget, whereby you're investing in a vision, right? So for example, if you're investing in a omni-channel, typically if you're a traditional thinker, then okay, we'll assign this much of the budget to implement a chatbot, and then assign this much allocation to a call center, right? But if you handle this on a more dynamic basis, then you gradually sense what is important, what is hot in the trend of what the customer wants right now. Do they need a voice bot rather than a chat bot? Would that be more practical? Or do they need other more of a human interactions with the call center?
What's a voice versus a chat bot? I know we talked about this before, but maybe for our audience.
Okay, so you'd be familiar with chatbots, right? And these are based on artificial intelligence. So instead of talking to or chatting to a live agent, you're chatting to a bot. That may not sound fun. Some people still want to chat to agents, but sometimes agents does not create good customer experience because us being humans, we don't know absolutely everything about the customer, or at least if we do, we're going to have to refer to the CRM or refer to other systems, right? Whereas the bot can directly access the customer information from the CRM and then tell you about the status of the claim, for example, that you just made. If you want to follow up on your claim or the loan status.
So wait, you're talking about a way to interact with a bot using voice only.
Yeah.
Voice so I may be imagining this, but you tell me if I'm far off base here. What you're saying is I call up an IVR, mm-hmm. and it says, "Hello, David. The status of your claim is," rather than me having to hit 2 for English, 4 for...
Yeah, I can't stand IVRs. I think, I just try to press 0 just so I can speak to the operator. And even if I get to speak to the operator, it may be different people, and if the call gets cut, I have to repeat everything, all my problems again to another person. That's a pain point, right? But if you're speaking about on simple use cases, like I want to change my mobile phone, I want to change my address, I want to track my claim status, these are the information that the bot can just provide to you 24 hours a day. Yeah, instant.
Yeah, I think anything that cuts down on the amount of time we have to interact with an IVR is going to be a solid NPS game for any bank that can do that.
Yeah, and it's not going to solve everything, but it would save, in some cases, it would improve the customer experience and save the company a great deal on, instead of hiring a whole masses of call center people, use the bots to handle these things.
So let's circle back to maybe a higher level challenge. So we talked a bit about cost of these sorts of transformations being potentially extremely expensive. Now, there's a certain role in the C-suite whose job is to ensure we keep our costs in check and our expectations.
I know who you mean.
Yeah. So let's talk about the CFO for a minute. So your CTO is the guy who wants to spend the money, The CEO is the guy who's got to write the plans and make sure that, you know, expectations are met. And you got a guy right here whose job is to make sure that the CTO doesn't spend too much money. I know it's not as simplistic as that for his role. He does more than that. But let's talk a little bit about the relationship here between these two roles. Now, it could be the CPO as well. It may be that it's that role's budget, that role's the spender. Maybe we need a new HRIS system, for example. But if we're talking about the CTO and the CFO, what are the frictions?
So the CTO would like all the cool and innovative stuff that half of them or more than half of them are shut down by the CFO, who's always asking, what is the return on investment in this? Right? What is the return on investment on a voice bot? A voice bot is not going to give you a return in the first year or two. Right? It's something that consumers are gradually getting traction. It's kind of new, especially in Thailand. The Thai NLP is maturing. So you see companies like telecoms or insurance and banking adopting this kind of technology. But you've got to get past the ROI guy, right? And with some of these innovation, some company already segregate the kind of spending to innovation spending and cost-cutting spending or other buckets, right? So things like voice bot falls under innovation. And with innovation, you can't really measure it with ROI. Right? There's a new measure called return on experience, or the ROI of experience, right? And this is a certain measure whereby you pick metrics such as the CSAT, the customer satisfaction score, or NPS, the net promoter score. Then you measure that, and then you pick certain operational metrics such as the cost of acquisition or cost of retention or lead generation. And then you combine that together and divide it by the cost of doing the transformation, and then you can get that kind of score. It's more complicated to calculate than the ROI. This is why the value may
sometimes... Well, conceptually, So, I mean, this is, I think, part of the conversation we had before. So, this is my opinion, but there's some research behind this. We all want to do better at our job. We want to learn new skills, we want to advance, we want to push the envelope, we want to maybe be challenged in some meaningful way as we progress through our careers. The person that's hit the CFO office is, other than moving into a CEO role, is pretty well on the top of his or her game. But that doesn't mean that they don't want to be challenged and learn something new. So let's put it on the table that the CFO wants to learn a new way.
Yeah.
Is looking real hard at this innovation thing and is seeing, you know, the successes of Tesla and the successes of Microsoft and a variety of other tech firms around the world, and is saying, wow, they're doing some cool stuff.
Yeah.
I want to know what's going on with the books. Mm-hmm. And so if we're to describe this in plain language, what is this return on experience? Like, ignore the facts and figures and variables that are necessary. What are we really trying to measure? I mean, ROI is easy, but what is this?
Okay, let me give you some example. Return on experience, one of the measures would be, for example, if you retain your customer by 5%, then I can expect the profit to be increased by, say, 25%, for example.
Hmm.
This is a measure of the return on it. On experience, or if you say you can work out from the company data that new customer, no, it's easier to, it costs like 6 times less to sell to existing customer than to acquire new customer. Okay. So then you can back calculate and then derive the value of that, the monetary value, and calculate what I can expect from experience. So in some cases you can measure quite solidly, some you can't really quantify the experience, right? Unless you have the CSAT scores and those kind of things. But even that is kind of a limited scope on how do you quantify your feeling?
There are ways. But no, I get your point.
Yeah.
So I mean, to me, I haven't got quite the right word to describe this, but it almost sounds like a language that a lot of startups will use, particularly in the early phases of their growth cycle, as they begin to describe that hockey stick what they're doing is they're describing how many new people are coming and how long are they staying and how much are they spending. And it's more, I don't want to call it a churn calculation, but it's an activity calculation. Would that be a fair way to think about it?
Is that a way to win against the traditional CFOs? Another way to explain the benefit of implementing these innovations, because if the ROI doesn't, the number is not so pleasing to their eyes, then you're going to have to present them something else. And another tip I could give in handling like CFOs or the people or even the CEO, the people who have to approve on certain budgets on the innovation is to make incremental benefit, to focus on your MVPs, right, the minimum viable product for whatever you're trying to implement. It give you a simple analogy. Right? If your problem statement is to go from A to B, right, say 50 miles, then okay, the product that you need is probably a car. Right? So there are two ways of implementing this, a car. You can do the traditional way where after 1 month, you have a wheel. Second month, you have the second wheel, and then you gradually build on that until eventually, after say 6 months, just an analogy, you get a car, and then you can drive from A to B. Right? But during that time, you're not going to reap the benefit. You're not going to see the benefit. You're not going to see the customer feedback of your product because it's like a big bang kind of launch. But after a certain amount of time, you see the benefit of it. That's another way, and is to continue the analogy. Maybe in the first month you use a skateboard, in the second month you have a scooter, third month you have a bicycle that turns into a motorcycle and then a car, and then you get to see the customer feedback, what they actually want, right? In order to bring in an app or something that is or a product that is customer-centric, that is based not by what the company thinks the customer would like, but actually based on the research and the feedback from the customer, what they actually want.
See, what you're describing, I think a number of our viewers will have been familiar with the story of the skateboard. Yeah. But what you're describing is agile, mixed with design thinking,
really.
Yeah. And so, from a transformation perspective, again, I like the human side of interacting with technology a lot. This is a difficult mindset shift. Moving from, I'm going to build the whole car, which means I need a factory, and I need tools and die, and I need 100 people to assemble the thing, to, you know what, I think we've got to figure out if somebody wants to go 50 miles in the first place. Okay, we think they do. Okay. We think they want to go faster than walking. What's the cheapest possible thing we can do? I think this minimum viable product, this experiment, this testing and iterating approach is a struggle for people that have been managing in conventional environments for the, let's call it, a couple of decades at least. So what have you seen in this respect? Like, has that been a struggle in the last few years for executives to transition to this?
I hardly see any projects that has been run on a fully agile basis, right? I mean, historically, agile came from IT. So there are certain IT projects would be running in agile manner. And in Thailand, I think most IT projects are now adopting agile, so have successfully adopted agile. But the next logical step is to what we call the scale agile, where it's not just the IT department doing the implementation that's running agile, but the entire organization, and that means executives are also part of the agile group. You have like a pilot group, team of people, you do your reporting in an agile manner, you coach the people on an agile manner. So the whole organization is adopting the agile way of working.
Mm. So is this, are we still early stages in the financial services industry in Thailand with this, or?
The banks have been very successful with adopting agile on a large scale. But banks being banks, this is so big that not all the projects and they will have to face the challenge of the legacy core, because the legacy core, you can't really do agile on that, unfortunately. So they find ways of working on a hybrid model, by some of them waterfall, some of them agile, and they kind of work together.
I mean, ultimately, we're talking about a difference in project management techniques. This is, it is heavy work. There's a lot of training involved in getting to this stage, but ultimately, we really are just talking about a difference in project management techniques. People will learn.
Yeah.
It might take some time, but from what you're saying, we're already underway in Thailand.
Yeah, of course. It's a cultural shift, and with all the cultural shift, it takes time.
Mm. So let's wrap things up with a little look at the Thai consumer. Mm-hmm. So I spent the last 5 years living, living in India.
Yeah.
And in that country, 65% of the population is under 35. This is very much a mobile-first, very digitized country that are quite hungry to try new things and willing to try new things.
Yeah.
But I haven't been in Thailand long enough to be able to make a qualified assessment.
Mm-hmm.
What's the scene here when it comes to financial products,
yeah,
retail banking products especially, but insurance products as well? What's the scene with the Thai consumer? Do they still want to walk into a branch and see a human, or do they want to do everything on their phone if they can?
I think that depends on the demography of the people. So the older generations, they would still want to walk to the bank to update their passbooks.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know. I never had a passbook when I was in the UK.
I had a passbook.
Yeah. Well, there are certain people who enjoy going to the bank branches to update the passbook. It feels good, it sounds good, and you get to see the balance, whether joy or depressing, I don't know. And then there are the newer generation, Z generation, Y, who wants to have like immediate way to transfer money, and that way they adopted the mobile banking, and especially mobile penetration is very high in Thailand. The internet is very high in Thailand, so mobile banking has been very popular, and especially in the COVID situation where you can't really go into the bank. I think the usage has spiked up by very high percentages. And there has been a study of whether Thais would be interested in like neobank, so a digital bank, and I think 65% would consider using digital banks, like purely digital banks. But would they shift from the traditional bank to a purely digital bank? No. They would still need a bank with a physical presence or somewhere they could run to lock the complaints or to know where their money is, rather than just an app that is holding their money in the digital format that they can't really touch and feel.
Well, that echoes experience of this is maybe going back 10 years, but this is a similar experience to Canadians. When I was a banker in Toronto, there were several what we described as neobanks, but they were, for most, they were a bank of two or a bank of three. You might have opened an account with a bank called PC Financial, which was a bank that was tied to a grocery store.
Yeah.
And you would have done that because there would have been some loyalty program, maybe there was some pricing advantage to them as well. But
mm-hmm.
There's several of these types of banks that still exist, but for most Canadians, they're a secondary or even a tertiary bank. But here, I suppose this is the same question crops up. Why has there been a need for a neobank? Why have they found success that they have? And you answered the second question. The Thai will not have it as the only bank.
Mm-hmm.
But why have they managed to find opportunity, and why have the traditional banks not been able to meet that need?
Because most of the neobanks come from fintech, or at least, if not the homegrown fintech, then would be like a spin-off company from banks, right? So why do they need to spin off? Because they don't want to be latching on the legacy system that are not allowing them to improve the customer experience. So you start from scratch, you use a digital core, and then you can improve on the experience very fast. So consumers benefit from better customer experience. higher interest because the overheads are less.
Right.
These banks can afford to give their customers slightly higher interest. I'm not talking about 10% here, it's still like maximum 1.7 or thing, which is better than none or better than 1%, right? And they can derive other features such as personal finance, the way that you track your spending. A few years ago, I transfer money in Thailand, and I don't even know who transferred the money to me because I get, say, 2,000 baht in my bank account. I have no idea who transferred this to me. It doesn't say exactly now. Now that's apparent. But beyond that, it kind of does the analysis for you. Like, can you spend like 20% of your income on food and drinks and another 10% on gadgets, for example? Kind of categorize the way that you spend your money, and some of the banks even go further into giving robo-advisory, like how you want to invest on something, get the robo-advisory to invest for you on your behalf. And I'm not talking about a massive amount of money. You can start from like 3,000 baht.
Well, I think, I mean, this is an area that I find interesting. I think most bankers, retail bankers especially, would be fascinated with what's happening in the world of robo-advisory. And the example that you gave about tracking your expenses and being told, hey, you're spending this much on coffee, that much on takeout food.
Yeah.
I think this is a good first step. Mm-hmm. We know from the research that we all follow a type of mental shortcut, which is called mental accounting.
Yeah.
It means that even absent some computer or app telling us that we spend X on coffee, Y on food, we've already budgeted for all this. So we have, in our minds, we've got X that goes for rent or mortgage, Y that goes for car payment, Z that goes for entertainment, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I think we've learned quite a bit that one of the reasons that we struggle, regardless of whether Indian, Arab, Thai, Canadian, American, is this mental accounting problem. We struggle to save more money simply, or to pay back debts that we have, simply because we feel that we're going to have to take money from a certain category. So let's say, for example, the classic example of this is an early study in the mid-90s in a small town in the Midwestern states. A bunch of researchers went in, and they asked the small mining town or factory town of 5,000 people. These are very, very traditional manufacturing kind of town. These guys would have been earning middle class salaries, would have been single income as often as not, you know, wife at home, couple kids. They asked them a question: do you want to save more money? They all said yes.
Yeah.
No, statistically, like 97%
said yeah,
yes. Right. They all said yes. And the second question was: can you save more money? And the answer was no. You couldn't. And the reality was, when they looked at it, they would come to, usually it was the dad, but they would come to the father and they would say, hey, listen, do you want to save $100 a month next month? And where his head goes is the only variable expense that he had after food, rent, mortgage payment, car, was his once a week or once every 2 weeks out with his buddies at the bar. It meant him giving up his couple of drinks or his poker night or his fun. And he was like, this is the last vestige of fun that I have. I don't want to give you $100 for that. So I'm not going to do it. It was just a block. However, what they were able to do was they were to leverage a type of almost like a reset or a reconciliation function.
Mm-hmm.
So we reset the amount of money at a certain frequency that we have available in all these various accounts.
Mm-hmm.
And so what they did was they leveraged this little reality that in small town factory kinds of employment, these guys were unionized and their salaries were indexed to inflation. So the following year, salary would go up by 3% or 5% or somewhere thereabouts.
Yeah.
And the researcher would say, hey, listen, would you save $100 a month next year? Would you give me that money then? And they would say, and that, at this point, we found that 3 out of 5 signed up, and after 5 years, it was a, like 180% improvement in savings. And it was exactly the same thing. It was just that he hadn't yet allocated the money to that fund account yet.
Because he doesn't know which how he spends his money. Right? And that's a typical feature of a digital bank, is they are able to give you a transparency on how you spend, what you can do with the money. For example, I'm trying to save up for a holiday. I may need to cut off 2 pints of beer per week for a period of time so that I can afford that holiday, for example. That's the kind of things that a bank or a digital bank can offer you. And beyond that, once you put in more of the intelligence and machine learning into that kind of platform, you may be in the future be able to answer things like, am I better off buying a BMW or using Grab executive car over a period of years? Which one would I save more money? Which one am I better off? That's not something that a clerk in a bank can answer you. And that's not something that a mobile banking app would be able to answer you.
True. At least not right now, but you did give me a good story to dig into next time. Grab executive car versus BMW. Interesting.
I have done that calculation. For my traveling, I would be better off using Grab BMW than buying my own. Cost is relative, but I'd be saving up on driver costs as well.
Well, listen, I've done a similar calculation. It's not as expensive and fancy as a car, but I didn't bring my road bike to Thailand. I left it with a friend in India. And I recently discovered a park called Skylane out by the airport. It's a 23-kilometer bike loop.
Yeah.
Same deal. You can rent. Right now, I rented an Italian bike that is 5 times more expensive than I would ever buy. And it's my weekly bike. And I ride this thing for 900 baht, and I could ride that thing every week for years before I could justify buying the Italian bike.
Yeah. And same question, am I better off renting an apartment or buying an apartment for my lifestyle? Right. That's the kind of things that maybe one day the digital bank can give me an answer based on my lifestyle, based on my spending, based on my preference.
That is a conversation we could spend another hour on. So, Tan, this has been awesome. Thank you so much for today. So, what's up and gob? Appreciate this so much. Thanks, Tan.
Thank you.